Well, good evening, guys. Good to see you again tonight. And to those who will listen and over the coming days, welcome to pray God's blessing upon you as well. And that as we pray for the Lord's ministry to our hearts tonight, we pray that you too, as you listen to what he's saying to you, will be blessed and encouraged by it. Just before we pray and get into it, just to give you a bit of an update on Dave and Vicky. They've had a difficult week, but they're showing some early signs of improvement, I think is what we'd say. So they'd really value your prayers, continued prayers, and hopefully they'll be back with us soon. But keep them in your prayers, and the children are doing good, I think, aren't they, Sue? But Dave and Vicky have had a pretty rough few days, so let's keep remembering them in our prayers at this time. Okay, let us pray and then we'll get into our study together tonight. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your amazing love and grace towards us, your children. Lord, we thank you for your promised presence with us tonight as we gather around your word, and we invite you, Holy Spirit, into this time. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would speak through your servant tonight. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would minister to each one of our hearts that which we need to hear from you, and as we listen in coming days, so too, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you know each one of our hearts and exactly where we are, and your word is living and active, and you speak through your word directly into each of our hearts as we open ourselves to you and as we seek you. So, Lord, we pray for this time, and we trust it and submit it into your hands right now, and pray that you would be glorified, Lord. You would be exalted as we look at your word together, that our understanding of you would grow, and we would just continue to be amazed at the God that we are growing to love and to serve more and more. So bless us, Lord, in this time now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so we're looking at 1 Samuel chapter 18 tonight, if you want to turn there. Cliff took us through chapter 17 last week, David and Goliath, and we're going to look at the whole of chapter 18 tonight. And I think what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to read the whole chapter to you so that we get a feel for the chapter as a whole, and then share a few thoughts with you from the chapter. So we're reading from verse 1, 1 Samuel chapter 18, and we're really closing off in these early verses the account of what happened with David and Goliath in chapter 17. So verse 1 says, "Now when he had finished speaking to Saul," that was David, "the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan took off the robe that was on him and gave it to David, with his armor, even to his sword and his bow and his belt. So David went out wherever Saul sent him and behaved wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all the people and also in the sight of Saul's servants. Now it happened as they were coming home, when David was returning from the slaughter of the Philistine, that the women had come out of all the cities of Israel singing and dancing to meet King Saul with tambourines, with joy, and with musical instruments. And so the women sang as they danced, and they said, 'Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000s. Then Saul was very angry, and the saying displeased him, and he said, "They have ascribed to David 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed only thousands. Now what more can he have but the kingdom?" So Saul eyed David from that day forward. And it happened on the next day that the distressing spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied inside the house. So David played music with his hand, as at other times. But there was a spear in Saul's hand, and Saul cast the spear, for he said, I will pin David to the wall. But David escaped his presence twice. Now Saul was afraid of David, because the Lord was with him, but had departed from Saul. Therefore Saul removed him from his presence and made him his captain over 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. And David behaved wisely in all his ways, and the Lord was with him. Therefore when Saul saw that he behaved very wisely, he was afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he went out and came in before them. Then Saul said to David, here is my older daughter, Merab. I will give her to you as a wife. Only be valiant for me and fight the Lord's battles. For Saul thought, let my hand not be against him, but let the hand of the Philistines be against him. So David said to Saul, who am I, and what is my life or my father's family in Israel that I should be son-in-law to the king? But it happened at the time when Merab, Saul's daughter, should have been given to David, she was given to Adriel the Meholathite as a wife. Now Michal, Saul's daughter, loved David. And they told Saul, and the thing pleased him. So Saul said, I will give her to him, that she may be a snare to him, and that the hand of the Philistines may be against him. Therefore Saul said to David a second time, you shall be my son-in-law today. And Saul commanded his servants, communicate with David secretly and say, look, the king has delight in you and all his servants love you. Now therefore, become the king's son-in-law. So David's servants spoke those words in the hearing of David. And David said, does it seem to you a light thing to be a king's son-in-law, seeing I am a poor and lightly esteemed man? And the servants of Saul told him, saying, in this manner David spoke. Then Saul said, thus you shall say to David, the king does not desire any dowry, but 100 foreskins of the Philistines to take vengeance on the king's enemies. But Saul thought to make David fall by the hand of the Philistines. So when his servants told David these words, it pleased David well to become the king's son-in-law. Now the days had not expired. Therefore David arose and went, he and his men, and killed 200 men of the Philistines. And David brought their foreskins, and they gave them in full count to the king, that he might become the king's son-in-law. Then Saul gave him Michal, his daughter, as a wife. Thus Saul saw and knew that the Lord was with David, and that Michal, Saul's daughter, loved him. And Saul was still more afraid of David. So Saul became David's enemy continually. Then the princes of the Philistines went out to war. And so it was, whenever they went out, that David behaved more wisely than all the servants of Saul, so that his name became highly esteemed. We're going to look at the first four verses to start off with, just to close David and Goliath and pull out one or two things from this new relationship, new friendship between David and Jonathan. And then we're going to get into the rest of the chapter, which really provides us with a real contrast between Saul, the rejected king, and David, the anointed king. And we'll draw some thoughts together out of the rest of the chapter as we look at that together. One of the things that really struck me as I was first just thinking about this was the picture we have of David, from David and Goliath, of the spiritual battle. There are two kingdoms, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world. And David to us is a picture of the kingdom of God, and Goliath was a picture of this world. And of course you remember, and Cliff took us through much of the detail in the chapter last week. Cliff, in verses 8 and 9, Goliath challenges Israel with the words, choose a man from amongst you. and come and fight against me. And whichever man wins, the other nation, the nation of the winning party, the winning man, they will rule over the others, and the losing man will be the servant. And it's just a great picture to us of what Jesus has done for us, and Jesus's victory over sin, over Satan, and over this world, and our hope in Jesus. And the key point there was that whoever was the victor, then the other nation had to follow the victor. And so when Jesus, with Jesus as our victor and as our king, we look to him, we lift in him, and we follow him, and our lives are completely linked into Jesus. One of the scriptures that really speaks about this is Colossians 3, verse 3. It says, "For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him." And Paul, as he's writing to the church at Colossae, he's saying there that when we come to Jesus, our lives are completely hidden in him. As he died on the cross for our sins, we died there for it, with him on that cross. As he was raised from the dead by the Father, so we too are raised into newness of life with Jesus. We are identified with him. His victory is our victory, and our life is in him. And as we grow, we go on in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the picture that we get from this battle here. And at the end of it, Jonathan, at the beginning of chapter 18, now as we get into chapter 18, we as heard the conversation between David and Saul. So if you think when David was taken to Saul back in chapter 17, Jonathan heard David's faith in God, his confidence in God, his desire to honor the Lord and go out and defeat this Philistine who was attacking and challenging the children of Israel, trusting that his God was able to give him victory. And of course, when we were back in 1 Samuel chapter 14, if you remember Jonathan did in a similar way, went out against the Philistines with his armor bearer and says, maybe the God will be with us. And Pastor Dave took us through that chapter, and that great chapter of Jonathan's faith in stepping out in God and step by step trusting God to see if God would bring victory to them. And two similar hearts, and yet in this instance we find that Jonathan's silent and all the men of Israel are silent, but David stands on their behalf. And David in the scriptures is a picture of the Lord Jesus, and the Lord goes before us and fights on our behalf. And at the end of the battle, Saul talks to David again concerning the battle, and Jonathan hears all the conversation. And as Jonathan sees David's faith in God, David's trust in God, and desire to see him honored, it draws from Jonathan a deep love in friendship with David. And it says his soul, it was knit with David's soul. And the first thing that really I want to challenge us with tonight is, in the light of all that Jesus has done for us, are our souls knit with that same deep love for Jesus? Do we have that great depth of love and desire for our Lord and Savior Jesus, as Jonathan had for David, who had gone out as the victor for the children of Israel over the Philistines? Jesus is the one who has brought victory over sin and death and given us eternal life in him through his death and resurrection, through his sinless life for us. And is that drawing from us, that response of love in all that Jesus has done for us? And that, hopefully, in our lives is a deepening love for the Lord. The more we understand of Jesus, the more we experience his love, his grace, and his care in our lives, the more deeply we fall in love with him, and our souls are knit to the Lord. Just one verse linking to that as a bit of a guide to us in the evidence of that love. John 14, verse 15, Jesus in his final teachings to the disciples says, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments." There's a real evidence to our love. It's not just a spoken word. It's a love that draws from us a response in obedience to all that the Lord's word, and in obedience to all that, to him for all that he has done for us, and with a desire to love him and to serve him and to honor him. And Jonathan followed that up by making a covenant with David. And again, a serious commitment between the two of them, one that would be and will be tested as we go forward in the coming chapters in Samuel. That covenant between David and Jonathan will be seriously tested, because Jonathan is the son of Saul. Jonathan is the heir to the throne, but he is making a covenant with David without knowing, and Saul wouldn't have known at this time, that David was God's anointed to be king. Although we find Jonathan saying very quickly, "You'll be king in my place." And as we look at this now, again, we see Jonathan's understanding of that already, because the third thing that really strikes me here is that Jonathan, in verse 4, gives to David all the things that relate to his position as heir to the throne, as the potential successor, as the son of Saul. So in verse 4 we find Jonathan took off the robe that was on him, his royal robe, and he gave it to David. He took off his armor, his sword, his bow and his belt, the things that identified him as the heir to the throne. He took them off and he gave them to David and submitted himself. He effectively abdicated from the throne and put his trust in David, who we saw as God's anointed to take the throne. And again, that just strikes to me as a real point for us as believers, really, that when we come to Christ, we abdicate the throne of our lives. And we invite Jesus to be the King and Lord over our lives. And it's that submission of the whole of our lives to the Lord that we do. Just this afternoon, I was reminded of a book by a guy called Robert Boyd Munger, who one or two of you may have heard of. And the book is called My Heart, Christ's Home. And it's a really short book, but it speaks about inviting Jesus into every room in the home, every room of the house, and inviting the Lord to go through each room or each compartment of our lives and search out what should be there and what should be there, shouldn't be there. And what the writer said was, as he went from one room to another, he was able to give over one room to the Lord, but then found he was taking back control of that room as he went on to look at the next room. And in the end, he realized that the answer was to invite Jesus to actually rule the home, to give the title deeds of the home to Jesus, and to submit himself wholly unto the Lord. And I think as Jonathan submitted himself to David and recognized that David would be the king, so we are exhorted to just again keep looking at our own lives and say, am I really submitting all aspects, all areas of my life to Jesus? Is he Lord of all, or am I holding back things that from my old life perhaps that are still precious to me and that I want to hold on to? Like John the Baptist in John 3 verse 30, I think we must say, he must increase but I must decrease, as we submit ourselves unto the Lord and we look unto Jesus. And just in these opening verses, those are the thoughts that really strike out to me. The the depth of Jonathan's love for David as he sees what David as the saviour of Israel, as he would look at it, what God had done through David, so we love him and submit ourselves in love to him. And as we make that covenant with the Lord, it's not a covenant about salvation. It's a desire to serve him and to love him and to stand for him in all things and in all situations. My other thought from these first verses is in verse 2. It says, Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore. And one of the things I love when I'm studying characters in the scriptures is seeing how God shapes lives and how God works in and through lives to prepare us for the things that he has for us and to be the men and women that he has called us to be. And, you know, when we're looking at David, if we're not careful, we can just glide past the fact that this is a shepherd boy who was the eighth son of Jesse, not even invited to the feast when Samuel went to anoint the next king, but one who was left out in the field to look after the sheep. One who, when his brother, when he came to the battlefield, as we saw last week and Cliff touched on last week, was scorned by his brothers for who he was and for his status. How does this young boy become the king of Israel? And here in verse 2, we see Saul inviting him into the royal household. We'd seen a little bit back in chapter 16, haven't we, where David went to play music to Saul. When Saul was distressed and struggling, David went and played music to him and brought peace to him. Now in chapter 18, it's going on to the next stage. And Saul did not let David go home again after that. But David became a member of the royal household. In verse 5, we find that Saul appointed David over the men of war. And as king, David would face many battles. It's interesting that in 1 Chronicles 28, verse 3, David, towards the end of his life, had a real good desire to build a house for the Lord, to build the Lord's temple. And the Lord says, you can't build it, but your son Solomon can build it. And the Lord said, you're a man of war. And because you've been a man of war, your son Solomon will build the house, and that the temple for the Lord, the house for the Lord, in 1 Chronicles 28, verse 3. And it just strikes me that here David is being placed in that position where he would learn to command men and to lead men and to rule men. A shepherd boy now being put in a place of authority really quickly, but where he would learn to lead men. It's like Moses. Moses' first 40 years was spent in the house of Pharaoh, where he learned the ways and was taught in the ways of Egypt, where he was a commander in the Egyptian army before he killed a man and fled, and then spent years where God did a different work in his heart. But God equipped Moses in those first 40 years to lead a nation through the wilderness for 40 years and to take them to the promised land. And God does the same thing in our lives. He's working in us to help us and to prepare us and to for the things that are ahead. And we learn as we walk step by step in him. In verses 10 and 11, we see God overruling, in this chapter, Saul's attempt to kill him. When we get into the second part of the chapter in a bit more detail, with Merab and Michal, we see that Merab was not to be the wife of David. The scripture doesn't tell us clearly why she wasn't, whether David was hesitant, whether Merab didn't want David, whether Saul changed his mind and decided to, if you like, push David down by giving Merab to somebody else. We don't know. But we do know that Michal was given to David as wife. And as we look at that, and we see in, when we get into chapter 19 next week, we find that Michal not only loved him, but was willing to go against the father and was instrumental in David's deliverance and being set free when Saul sent men to kill him in chapter 19. And so we see the sovereign hand of God just in these early, through this chapter, things coming out in this chapter, where God is leading David, teaching David, protecting David, but helping him to grow into the man that he wants him to be. And as we know, this was a long process. David would spend about 20 years from initial anointing to actually becoming the king as God worked in and prepared his lives. And we know in our lives that God's work is a lifetime work. And hopefully we grow as we go. But God is working in us. Even just one other thing from the last chapter. You know, just the simple thing. When Jesse sent David to the battlefield at exactly the right time to take food to his brothers. Why did Jesse do it on that particular day, the 40th day? But God's hand was on it. And sometimes we can miss just in the simple things how God is working in our lives and guiding us and leading us and the things that he's teaching us through those things. But I love those things. They really encourage me in God to know that even when I can't understand certain things that are happening, that God has a purpose in them and that nothing is wasted in him. And we'll see that more and more as we go through this chapter. So if we pick up in the next section, from verses 5 right through to 16, we really get the contrast between Saul and David. As I said at the beginning, the rejected King Saul and the anointed king to be David, and the differences in the characters of the two men. One of the key verses in this is verse 12. It says, Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him and had departed from Saul. The Lord was with him. It wasn't about David's natural giftings, but it was God's grace and God's presence with David that made the difference. And it's the same for you and I today. The key thing for us, if we're going to be faithful and useful in the kingdom of God, is that we're walking in his presence, that he is with us, and that his grace and mercy are working in and through our lives. It doesn't matter what area of ministry within the body we're involved in. The key to our ministry is the Lord with us in that ministry? Is it God who's speaking? Is it God who's reaching out and ministering through us in this time? Let's just quickly whiz through this section. So verses 7 and 8, we find the women coming out to celebrate the return of an army was not a one-off thing. It was a fairly common thing as the women celebrated when the victorious king returned from battle, and they rejoiced in the victory that they'd been given. If you go right back to Exodus 15, when the Egyptians chased the children of Israel when they left the land, and when the children of Israel crossed the Red Sea and the Egyptian army sought to follow through, but the Lord brought the waters together again and the whole Israel army was drowned and the soldiers were killed. Miriam sings a song of praise in Exodus 15, verse 21, honoring the Lord for the great things that he has done. The interesting thing for me in this is that Miriam's praise gave God all the glory. And in this, the song is Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000s. But the song that they sang, whichever, I mean, King Saul was the focus of their celebration. But the fact that they recognized what David had done over what Saul had done caused great difficulty for Saul. And one of the things we see coming through in Saul's life, and you maybe picked it up already just as we read the chapter, is his great jealousy and envy of David. And here, the rejected king, the one who was lost at the presence of the Lord, who is stood on his own and out of his depth, hears what's being said. He's already seen his own son recognizing and acknowledging what God had done through David. Now he sees the people acknowledging the great victory that David has won. And if you go back into chapter 15, when Saul was rejected by Samuel's word in 1 Samuel 15, verse 28, it says there, "The Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to a neighbor of yours who is better than you." And Saul would have remembered those words, and now here he's hearing this. David's slain his 10,000s, but you, Saul, have only slain your thousands, one better than you. And it says in verse 9 that Saul eyed David from that day forward. In other words, from that day forward, he treated him with the utmost suspicion, and as we see in the rest of the chapter, was looking for ways to kill David and to remove David from the position that he was in, even though David was doing great things. And it just shows us how divisive and how destructive jealousy and envy can be. James 3 verse 16 says, "For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there." Proverbs 14 verse 30 says, "A sound heart is life to the body, but envy is rottenness to the bones." The scriptures speak very clearly about the sin of jealousy and envy. And there's just a warning to us in this. Human nature is often wanting to promote self. And it can slide into the church as well. Sometimes we can be jealous of what God is doing through somebody else's life. Sometimes we're jealous that they've got a ministry that we would like, but God has called us into a different area. Sometimes we're envious of not so much the spiritual ministry, but just what we perceive to be an easy life or a quality of life that we think we would like, when often we've no idea actually some of the challenges and difficulties that a brother or sister might face. You know, it might seem great to us at a distance. You know, you've heard the phrase, the grass is always greener somewhere else. It's when you find yourself in the place where you think the grass is greener that you realize that actually it wasn't that much greener after all, and there are many challenges there. But we can easily be envious of others and jealous of others. And yet in the family of God, this must be a place where we rejoice in what God is doing with one another. And we give praise and thanks, and we celebrate with our brothers and sisters the great things and the good things that God is doing in our lives. And whatever we're involved in, we look to the Lord, not to man, for our recognition. And I think that's really important. I wrote a couple of scriptures down, and I just thought the key thing about these two scriptures is that we need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, not on man. The first is Psalm 146 verse 3. It says, "Do not put your trust in princes, nor in a son of man, in whom there is no help." And Psalm 37 verse 7 says, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. But keep your eyes on the Lord." God has got a perfect plan for each one of our lives. And we don't need anything extra to what the Lord's plan is. And Paul, writing to Timothy, young pastor in the church, in 1 Timothy 6, verse 6, reminds him that godliness with contentment is great gain. And we need to rest in what God has gifted us with and what God is calling us to, and be faithful in our service and ministry for the Lord. Saul was riddled with jealousy and envy over David, desperately trying to hold on to something that God had already taken from him, and his life had fallen apart. One other scripture that I really like around this kind of thought is 1 Corinthians 4 verse 7, which says, "For who makes you differ from another? And what do you have that you did not receive? Now if you receive it, why do you boast as if you'd not received it?" And I'm often drawn to this scripture because it's a reminder to us that however God uses us, the gifting to you to serve him in that way comes from the Lord. It's not down to our ability, our skills, our talents. God might give different talents to each one of us, but actually the use of the gift is the Spirit of the Lord working in and through us. And it's God who's given us those things anyway. You know, if God's blessed you with a good brain, you didn't create that brain. God gave you it. If you're incredibly good at practical things, that's how God made you. And how God called you to serve him and to live for him. Saul just could not handle David and was desperately trying to hold on. Whereas David, in contrast, seems to be totally unmoved by the praise of the people. He quite happily goes back in verses 10 and 11 to playing his instrument to try and help calm down Saul when the distressed spirit comes upon him once again, and Saul is babbling and wound up. It says prophesied in verse 10, but I don't think that's a very good translation of the word. It's kind of babbling and going on, and Saul's wound up and struggling, so much so that he casts a spear at David. But David is happy to serve Saul. I mean, as we read through the chapter, you see that whatever Saul asked David to do, he was ready to do it. He was willing to serve Saul in any way. David did nothing to seek the fulfillment of the anointing that God had placed upon him. But he humbly submitted himself to Saul and served him and did what he asked of him because he trusted himself to the Lord. His life was in God's hands. The timing of what God was doing in his life was in God's hand, not his hand. So he didn't try and force things to happen and to come through. Sometimes we do that and we seek to push forward. But David just did everything for God and for his glory. Colossians 3:23 says, "Whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men." And that should be our aim, that in everything we do, we're doing it for his praise and for his glory, and humbly submitting to the Lord and praying for his help to do what he's called us to do, and never seeking to do it in our own strength. The other thought from verses 10 and 11, again, is just that reminder to us of the Lord's protection over us. I'm sure David was completely caught by surprise when Saul suddenly, as David's playing, picks up the sword in his hand and throws it at David and tries to pin him to the wall. And does it twice, it says. You know, he says, and he escaped it twice. There's no sign of David picking up the spear and firing it back at him. But David is submitted to the Lord, and the Lord protects him. And just to encourage us that in the uncertainties and the difficulties of life, we can always rely upon the certainty of God and upon his hand upon us to protect us, to keep us, and to watch over us. And you know, some of us, some are going through really difficult things. Some of us have been through difficult things. Some of us will be facing real challenging things just around the corner. But the hope and the certainty and the assurance that we have as we read the scriptures is that God is with us and will keep us through those things, whatever it might be and however unexpectedly it might appear to come upon us. Psalm 34:7 says, "The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers him." Daniel 3, we find Jesus stood in the midst of the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego when they were thrown into the furnace for refusing to bow down to the idol. In chapter 6, we find Daniel thrown into the den of lions, but the Lord closing the mouths of the lions until Daniel came out the next day. And then when those who'd put him in there were thrown in, the lions were very hungry and ate them straight away. When we're about the Lord's business, his hand will be upon us and we can trust him to watch over us and to keep us. A verse I often quote around this thought is from Exodus 34, verses 23 and 24. And that talks about when the men of the children of Israel were called to go to Jerusalem three times every year to celebrate the three main feasts of the year. And God's promise to them in those verses that when they go up to Jerusalem, he will watch over their families back at home and protect their belongings and their possessions. We can trust God to keep us and to watch over us. Verses 12 and 13, Saul, afraid of David because the Lord was with him and had departed from Saul. It says, "Therefore Saul removed him from his presence and made him captain over 1,000. Not clear whether that captain over 1,000 is a demotion from what he had before. But the thing that really struck me on this was Saul was convicted by David's life. But rather than repent and turn his heart back to the Lord and seek the Lord for forgiveness, Saul pushes him out of his presence, away from him. And we see the real hardness of Saul's heart, that he's alone, he doesn't know what to do, he knows from what Samuel has told him the Lord's taken the kingdom, he knows the Lord's presence has departed from him, but there's just no willingness to repent and to turn back to the Lord. And just an encouragement to us, sometimes we mess up. And sometimes when we mess up, we find it difficult to really go back to the Lord. Sometimes when we mess up, we're embarrassed or we're disappointed with what we've done. So we stop coming up to church. The very place that we need to be, we run from because we fear being there, whether it's because we feel unworthy or whatever, but we stay away from the Lord's presence. But the exhortation to us, and what we'll see in David's life later, is that when David sinned, the moment he was aware of it, he turned to the Lord and sought his forgiveness. Psalm 51:3 and 4, after the incident with Bathsheba, David turned to the Lord when Nathan revealed his sin to him and said, "I acknowledge my transgressions. My sin is ever before me. Against you, that is the Lord, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight." And a few verses later in verse 10, he says, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." David was quick to seek the Lord's forgiveness and to be restored. You know, the glorious thing for us as Christians is that though we sin and we do fall short and we do mess up, God has made a way through Jesus for immediate forgiveness of sins when we confess it and restoration back into fellowship. We don't need to live outside the Lord's fellowship. God has made a way for us to return to him. Ephesians 4:26 and 7 say, "Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sin go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil." And I just like that thought. You know, sometimes when we don't deal with things straight away, we give an opportunity to the enemy to work in our lives negatively. I'm going to very quickly look at the last part of the chapter, verses 17 through to 30. And I think one of the key things here, we find Saul saying one thing, but in his heart wanting another result to it. So in verse 17, it says, Saul said to David, "Here is my older daughter, Merab. I will give her to you as a wife. Only be valiant for me and fight the Lord's battles." That sounds fine, doesn't it? Fight the Lord's battles for me, David. You know, that's what I want you to do. This is where we're at. We're fighting the Lord's battles. But then it says, "But Saul thought, let my hand not be against him, but let the hand of the Philistines be against him." Saul was saying one thing, but actually he had a different motive in his heart for David and was seeking to kill him. And we see that worked out, because when we get to Michal and the dowry that Saul asks of David, he asks for 100 foreskins of the Philistines, thinking that one, if David is going to kill 100 Philistines, he's at great risk that he might lose his life rather than get the 100 foreskins. But also, too, if he does that, he will be a stench in the eyes of the Philistines from that day forward, and the Philistines will be forever seeking David's life. Saul is seeking through this to put David in a position where his life is at risk and where hopefully someone else will do what Saul has not been able to do, so that Saul can continue as king and that David's life will be taken from him. And we just see a real deviousness in Saul. His words sound all right, but actually his heart's elsewhere and far from the Lord. Psalm 55 verse 21 says, "The words of his mouth were smoother than butter, but war was in his heart. His words were softer than oil, yet they were drawn swords." Proverbs 23:7, a verse that many of us will know, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he." And I think the thing for us here is, it's not just about what we say on the external. It's about our hearts and where our hearts are at. And trying to suggest that all our hearts are close to where Saul's were. But God sees every motive behind every action. And he searches out the hearts of men. You know, read Hebrews 4:13 or Psalm 139, the first four verses there, which remind us that the Lord knows exactly what we're thinking, what our motives are, and what we're trying to achieve. Here in this section, we see wonderfully, one, the Lord overrule what Saul's plan and purpose is. Two, yet again, we see the willingness of David to submit to Saul's leading. He fully, you know, David makes clear in verses 21 to 25 his unworthiness. We see his humility before Saul to be married to the wife of Saul's daughter. But his readiness to meet the dowry of Saul and to take the lives of 100 Philistines, that God might be glorified in that. And actually, David goes the extra mile and kills 200 Philistines and gives them as dowry to Saul for Saul's daughter. Saul is doing whatever he can. He's using his daughters to try and bring about his plan and purpose. But God is overruling what Saul is trying to do. And David, the man of God, is being gracious to Saul and submitting to Saul and seeking to serve him and to help Israel defeat their sworn enemies, the Philistines. Ultimately, David honoured Saul as his son-in-law. And just one thought, and we'll close really on this thought. David honoured Saul as his son-in-law. We are the adopted sons of the King of Kings, sons and daughters of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so too, as David sought to honour his earthly father-in-law, so we should honour our King, the Lord Jesus, and submit our hearts to him and live our lives for him. I guess throughout this little passage here that we're looking at from 17 to 30, that well-known scripture, Romans 8:28, just covers it perfectly. For we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. And again, Romans 8:31, if God is for us, who can be against us? Isaiah 12:2 says, behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for Yah, the Lord, is my strength and song. He also has become my salvation. The chapter closes, and I'm just going to read these verses as we close, from 28 to 30 again. Thus Saul saw and knew that the Lord was with David, and that Michal, Saul's daughter, loved him, and Saul was still more afraid of David. And Saul became David's enemy continually. The princes of the Philistines went out to war, and so it was whenever they went out that David behaved more wisely than all the servants of Saul, so that his name became highly esteemed. Man sought to destroy, but God in his abundant grace blessed, protected, and David grew in esteem amongst the people for his faithfulness to the Lord, for his trust in the Lord. And Saul continued on the path and will continue on the path that he's on, seeking David's life. Time and time again, as we go through these coming chapters, Saul will sometimes acknowledge his mistake and say, David, you're more righteous than I, but then just carry on again and seek to take David's life. But God overrules, and God is working in his man to bring about his purpose. And you know, what we see of God's purpose for David, it might be on a different scale, but God's purpose for each one of us, he will continue to work in our lives, through our lives, to bring about that plan and purpose for his glory and for his honour. And we, his children, as we trust in faith, can rejoice that our lives are safe and secure in his hands. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. Lord, you know each of our hearts. Lord, if we lack faith in any way to trust you, then Lord, we pray you'd increase our faith. You would quicken our hearts to stand upon your word, to trust more and more in you. And Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your grace that continues to abound towards us in so many ways. We love you, Lord. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the examples before us. And Lord, we thank you that day by day you continue to prove faithful in each one of our lives. Lord, bless us now and keep us in your grace, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thank you.